Hey guys, my name's Eric. Welcome to my channel, Minimalist Musician. I thought it'd be cool to wrap up the little series on the THR, which was supposed to be one video, it turned into more, by talking about the five things I learned recording with this minimalist setup. Usually I don't really have any kind of creative limitations when I'm recording. All the gear I own is fair game, and I definitely spend more time thinking about what I want to use sometimes than actually creating. This was really neat because I knew what I was going to use the whole time, and I got to spend all my time just worrying about getting the parts down. I actually think this could be the start of a cool little series, My Minimalist Rig. Let me know what you think down below. I'd love to take the same approach with some other gear and see what's possible. One point I really want to drive home here is that it's not actually the gear that matters, it's the idea. Just because I use the THR amp for this doesn't mean you have to run out and buy one if you want to create something like this. My challenge to you is just to use what you have already and don't let what you don't have stop you from being creative. This has been a fun experiment. I'm looking forward to doing some more of these in the future. So let's check out the five things I learned recording with this minimalist rig. Number one, with any new gear, you need to set aside some time specifically just to learn it, to figure out the ins and the outs, to load up the software on the computer if you're going to manipulate it that way, or your phone or tablet, however you intend to use it. I think a lot of people just get really excited right off the hop. They get the new piece of gear, they want to plug it in and start creating with it right away, and they're not necessarily very happy with the results they get. I know I've definitely fallen victim to that before, and I think it's really important to actually take the time just to learn how to create good sounds. For me, that means setting aside specific time just to play with it and not actually have any intention of creating anything that day. Maybe it's a couple of days. I know for me, when I started with the HX Stomp, it was a couple of weeks before I was actually ready to use it on a gig or any kind of recordings. And although it was really frustrating at the time, I'm really happy I did it that way. When I first got this, I did initially just plug it in and start playing. I did try and start recording, and I found I wasn't getting the sounds I really wanted, so I made sure to actually set aside an entire day where I could just play with the amp and create some presets before I started to jump into recording. My process was to go through and create five presets, like I talked about in the last video: a clean, something a little dirtier, a lead tone, bass, and acoustic. I knew roughly what I was going to do for the demo song, so I went in and I created sounds that I thought would be useful for that. I learned that I prefer to use the THR editor on the computer anytime I'm using my DAW, but that if I'm just playing with the amp in a room, I'm totally happy to use the phone or the tablet. What's great about spending that time initially is that next time you go to use it, even if it's for a completely different project, you have an idea of the sounds that you like and you actually have a starting point. So even though I might change the sounds for another recording project or if I was going to use it for some kind of a gig, I at least know the amps that I like and I've got a starting point to work from. I generally treat this digital stuff as if it was a real amp, and I don't tend to stray too far from the analog gear that I probably use in the real world most of the time. Maybe that's a bit boring, but it's been a great way for me to dig into these and not waste too much time. Since I started playing with more digital gear, I've found whenever I have to learn songs for a gig, it can take me almost twice as long as it used to because I'm fiddling so much with the sounds and I'm trying to dial in the presets right away. What I found is more useful is to actually separate those jobs out. Usually I'll go through and I'll actually learn the songs first, and then I'll come back later and I can work on the sound design. I find that by batching those two processes on their own, I tend to be a lot more efficient with my time. Once I've learned the songs and then I come back to create the sounds, I'm going to be using some similar sounds throughout the whole process, so I've got a starting point. The second thing I learned here was that limitations are really good for workflow. Because the THR has limited sounds in it, it's just got two delays. It's got a tape delay and a digital delay, a couple of verbs, and I'd already preset the amps that I wanted to use, so all I had to do is tweak them. I didn't spend a lot of time playing around searching for sounds. When I wanted a slightly different sound, I knew that GarageBand had some effects that I was going to use after the fact, so I was able to just go ahead and record the part and know I'd be able to change it later. The fact that GarageBand also has pretty limited effects and I wasn't using any kind of external plugins made it really quick. When I wanted to put a stereo delay on a track, I just had one choice. I didn't have to go searching through an entire plugin library and become overwhelmed with all of the choices. I know for me, when I'm in the creative process, it's best for me to just get the ideas down and then worry about them later. So even when I was coming up with ideas, I was totally comfortable with the idea of putting down a scratch track, moving on to the next part, and then coming back and finishing it later on. When you have more choices, you tend to spend more time playing instead of creating. At least that's true for me. Had I been using all of the gear I have available to me instead of just the THR, I don't know that I would have got this done in the time that I did, or maybe even got the results that I did, because I would have spent so much time fiddling with knobs and dials instead of actually just working. Third, I learned that at a certain point, how good gear is doesn't really matter anymore. We're living in a time where technology is so good that even less expensive things sound unbelievable. Getting hung up on needing to have something better is just gonna be a detriment to your creativity. That's a mindset I'm all too familiar with. There have been so many times where I put off creating because I didn't think I had the proper gear. I think some of the most successful creative people out there are the kinds of people that don't worry about this at all. The performance is what really matters. How you execute it really matters, and a good idea is gonna sound good no matter what you use. We've all heard the stories about how some of the sounds we love the most off of our favorite records were created with gear we might not have expected. Fourth, and this was a tough one for me, learning that it's okay when the take's not perfect. One of the limitations I imposed on myself was that every single instrument had to be one take. I could play it as many times as I wanted to, but it had to be straight through. The reason I did this was because there's no real good way to put a crossfade on in GarageBand as far as I know. So there wasn't really a great way for me to join two takes other than automating each track individually. And when I thought of that, I'd already decided on this one take idea. The tracks are far from perfect. I'm definitely not a slide player by trade. It's something I love the sound of and I'm inspired to do more of, but I haven't spent that much time on it over the years. I did a handful of takes and I ended up settling on the one I did just because of the way it sounded. There were a few places where I really liked the feedback that was coming through and just the general tone of the notes. And although I think I had some other takes where the intonation was a little bit better, I chose this one just for the general feel. I had a moment where I actually exported the track from GarageBand into Logic so I could check and see how far off my intonation was just by using the pitch editor. And I had to talk myself out of making the corrections and sending it back into GarageBand. If somebody had hired me to play on a track, that's a technique I might implement in an effort to give them the best quality track possible. I think there's some controversy around using tools like those, but I really think it's situational. This actually ended up being really good for me, because if I had the option to use Logic and to alter the pitch of a couple notes, I would have stopped after about the second take of the slide. Instead, I put it down and I came back to it later in the day and spent an hour just flushing the part out. That's a really good example of how you can take a creative project like this and turn it into more technical practice. By actively listening back to my track, I actually had to confront the fact that I could do a better job with a bit of practice. So instead of playing in the mix with my guitar pretty quiet to make it feel like I was playing along with the recording, I chose to just play along with the bass and the drums with my slide guitar louder than I would normally hear it. This let me really hear the notes, and I really took my time and worked on the intonation to get a better result. Although still not perfect, I did put some time in and I feel like a better musician because of it. With all of that in mind, the fifth thing that I took away from this experience is that craft is more important than the tools you use to execute it with. I've seen it time and time again, both in live situations or recorded situations. A skilled musician who understands the craft and understands how to manipulate sound is always going to sound good no matter the situation. If I went into this not knowing how to use delay, not knowing how to use compression, not having an understanding of where I wanted things to sit in the mix, I don't think I would have got the results that I did. That being said, I have a long way to go, especially when it comes to mixing and understanding the recording process. That's still pretty new to me. But over the last couple of years, I've worked to acquire a basic set of skills that allowed me to carry out this project. As always, thank you so much for being here. I truly appreciate your time. And remember, better records were made with less gear.